20 Tech Tips to Shake Up Learning with my good friend Kasey Bell, episode 337.
The 10-Minute Teacher Podcast with Vicki Davis. Every weekday, you'll learn powerful, practical ways to be a more remarkable teacher today.
So today we are at ISTE 2018. I'm recording a series of shows and we are with Kasey Bell from Shake Up Learning. And today, Kasey and I are going to have a little bit of a tech tip smackdown and get as many of her 20 tech tips as we can. Now you will want to check the infographic and her blog post that we will include. So Kasey, what is your first tech tip for teachers?
First of all, we have to shift our mindset because we just can't make these changes until we make some internal changes. You know, I talk to teachers all the time who tell me, I'm just not good with technology. And you know what? We just have to make up our mind that we're going to be positive about it and accept the fact that things are just not always going to go our way, but that's okay. But we're willing to learn and embrace these changes that are coming our way.
You know, the most important software in our classroom is really between our ears, and we have to shift our mindset before we can shift what we're doing in the classroom. That's so important. What's our next one?
Our next one is to get tech in students' hands. And that may seem obvious, but I know that I go into so many classrooms where it's the teacher holding and controlling all of the technology in the classroom. And we really have to get that shift over. And some teachers, especially teachers who have like one device or one iPad or something like that, they become so overprotective. But we really need to put it in students' hands to get them creating, to get them, you know, collaborating on these devices, or we're really never going to make a difference with technology. That we don't need it in the teacher's hands. We need it in the student's hands.
And creating and collaborating are two of the key words that you just said, Kasey. Okay, what's our next one?
So our next tip is not to integrate too many tools at once. You know, I'm a big fan of app smashing. I think it's great. It's fun. But it's something that you have to build up to. And sometimes we get a little too excited, especially people like me who love technology. We want to try everything. We're like, oh, I'm going to do this and this and this and this. And then you go into the classroom and the kids are confused. They've got to create a million different accounts. And it ends up taking away from the actual learning process itself. And so when we do that, we actually move too far away from our learning goals and we're just using technology for technology's sake.
And stereotypes never really help. People say, oh, kids love technology. And so they want to throw five apps at them at once. And it really does confuse the kids, doesn't it? Like just pick one and go with it for a little while.
It does. It does. We have to be really careful. You know, it's funny when you talk to students, what their reactions are, not always what you think they're going to be. They like their tech for their own reasons, but when it comes to using it in the classroom, it's a whole different ballgame.
Yes, I think that's very important. Okay, what's our next one?
The next tip is not to be afraid of letting your students teach you. And, you know, this was something I was really afraid of as an early teacher. I thought I had to have all the answers. And if I didn't, I would go send them, you know, searching for the answers, that I couldn't admit to students that I didn't know everything. But that's okay. And especially when it comes to technology, because we usually have at least a few, if not many, little tech experts floating around in our classrooms. And guess what? Kids actually learn better from each other than they do from us sometimes. So being able to do that, whether you have some sort of system or a tech team or things like that. I've got lots of school districts that I work with that have like a Chrome squad where there's an entire team of students who are dedicated to helping teachers and students learn how to use technology.
But it can be kind of uncomfortable when we feel like, okay, they know more than I do. But I will say this, when that happens, I will sit down and say, okay, teach me.
Exactly. And you have to accept that's the world we live in. I tell people all the time, I'm not an expert. I'm just learning and I'm sharing what I'm learning, because the moment I declare to be an expert in anything, it's going to change tomorrow and I'm not going to be the expert anymore. Things change too fast. We've got too many things on our plates and teachers need to kind of let go of some of that control to let that happen.
Well, in some ways, humility is the new brilliance.
So true.
We just have to be. Okay, what's next?
Along with that goes the ask three before me. And that's one of my favorite strategies. I've used that one for years. And it's just a fantastic way to get kids finding their own answers. And we really want to build that capacity, because I think one of the best skills we can teach kids today is learning how to learn, right? Finding, and not just finding a Minecraft video on YouTube, but finding the types of things that we need them to find. And so to get them to do that. Now, of course, they can ask human people, of course, course, but they could also make one of the three, like Google or YouTube, even as part of that. But that strategy can also free you up to be more of a facilitator, do, you know, pull small groups and work on conferences and things like that.
Oh, and it sets expectations that we're all learners together. And that's so important, because if they're just asking you everything, you're still the quote purveyor of all information, and you may slip back into expert mode and forget that we're all learning together. Okay, what's our next one?
One of my favorites is to package your online assignments. And I did a blog post and infographic on this particular tip alone. It's also in my book. But I feel like teachers sometimes miss out on one of the best reasons for putting their assignments online, and that's to package everything together. So, I mean, that's including like, okay, here's your directions with every single step, so they don't keep asking you every single question along the way. And then, you know, clarifying things, being able to tell them what you want them to do, to turn it in. You know, we've got so many difficult digital processes now, and sometimes depending on the project that may change, detail all of that out. You can always copy and paste it into the next one to save yourself time. You know, but also making sure that students know, hey, what can they do when they're actually finished? That was something my kids used to drive me crazy with. Ms. Bell, can I play a game? You know, so the every little step is there, whether they're moving on to work on some enrichment or they're moving on to the next learning goal. But there are actually 10 things that I have put into that tip itself, just on how to package your online assignments. And I think it can save teachers time in the long haul.
And, you know, so many teachers are going to HyperDocs for their digital literacy task boards, or just task boards of any kind, which is one of those things they can do when they're quote done. I mean, I can't stand, you know, what do I do when I'm done? Well, you're not done. We're all still learning, right?
Right.
Okay, what's our last one?
Our last one is about assessing the bells and whistles. And so I always tell teachers, don't focus on assessing the bells and whistles of the projects. You know, I've seen so many rubrics, I'm sure you have too, about, you know, a PowerPoint or a presentation or whatever. It had to have so many slides, so many transitions, so many images. That doesn't prove any kind of learning, really. They're going to learn those skills along the way, but to make sure that you're focusing your assessment on the goals and the standards that you're trying to address, and not so much on the technology itself. You know, especially when you start building in choice, you can't really build a rubric for all of the different scenarios, because they're going to be using the tools of their choice anyway. So you can't really assess all of those things if you're really building in that type of choice. So I think that's, again, sort of a shift in mindset and how we assess work. You know, we get caught up in technology. Oh, well, you've got to have things that count numbers, that really doesn't prove anything.
So as we finish up, it's easy for somebody to look at your blog post and feel like, okay, Kasey has it all together and she knows everything. What is the worst technology mistake you've ever made in the classroom?
Well, I do a good job, I think, of blocking out those worst moments, Vicki. I hide them deep inside. But, you know, I look back on the things that I did in the classroom and I learned so many hard lessons. I tell people, and I say this in my presentations all the time, confessions of a bad teacher. Like, I'm just like full confession here. I was not a perfect teacher. I'm still not a perfect teacher, but I've learned some hard lessons. I used to jump onto whatever technology bandwagon was coming out. Oh, this is cool. I want to try this. I'm going to do this tomorrow. No planning, no purpose, not tied to any learning goals.
Guilty. Do it too.
Yeah. You know, and sometimes it turns out really well and you learn something really cool. And sometimes you're like, the kids didn't learn anything. They just got frustrated. But you know, I actually had my students one year, I tell this story quite a bit, but using Read, Write, Think's the comic creator. Don't know if you remember that. And it was very simplistic, but I found it. I was like, oh, this is cool. I was teaching Edgar Allan Poe, and I told them to retell the Telltale Heart in their own words using the comic strip maker. And what happened was, because the tool was very limited, they didn't have a lot of characters to choose from, which they complained about. But I will tell you, sometimes that's brilliant. There can be some super creative projects that come out of limiting choice as well. well. So what happened was most of the kids chose the dinosaur to represent the old man in the story. So what they did was turn a horror story into a comedy. So when I got these comic strips, I was like, oh my gosh, these are hilarious. And so I was just thinking about it, and they were so, so funny to me. And it was a teachable moment. I'm like, hey, genre, we just had a genre change. Do you realize this? And so it ended up well, even though I didn't plan it so well.
So it's Kasey Bell from Shake Up Learning. We will link to her 20 tech tips. She also has a fantastic book, Shake Up Learning, Practical Ideas to Move Learning from Static to Dynamic. And if it's ISTE, you guys will be listening to this after we've done the panel, but we're actually going to be doing a Goog Smacked panel tomorrow with our friend Eric Kirks and Matt Miller, and that's going to be a lot of fun as well. So thank you so much for listening, and I think it's important to remember that there is a way to do technology change, but it starts with a shift in our mindset. You who are listening, you have to decide, I'm going to improve my classroom, and I'm going to change and improve, and then you have to pick what you're going to do. And that's the software that starts the whole process. Thanks for listening.
Thank you for listening to the 10-Minute Teacher Podcast. You can download the show notes and see the archive at coolcatteacher.com/podcast. Never stop learning.